I get the feeling that I would have been really impressed with this game, with Field Commander for the PlayStation Portable, if I got it when it came out on May 22, 2006. Developed by Sony Online Entertainment, Field Commander is a turn-based strategy game for the PSP, which must have been simply awesome and worth every penny when it first came out. But I got to play this game in October 2008, a little more than 2 years after it's been released. And the most disappointing thing is that the online lobbies of this game are now totally deserted. I imagine the multiplayer strategy that occurred during those days must have been pretty damn good, considering that the mechanics in play sound very intuitive. An email response system in which the battle plays out at the pace of the players involved. What's more disappointing is the fact that the game comes packed with a simple level editor. I wonder what kind of levels were shared when this game had some online popularity when it was first released. Alas, even without the online multiplayer feature, it's still a pretty solid game for the PSP since the single player campaign alone will provide close to 20 hours of playtime. There are close to 50 missions in this game, and for the most part, they're all fairly enjoyable since the strategy mechanics are easy to utilize. The units are basic, ranging from a typical grunt foot soldier to a powerful tank vehicles to air units to stealth units like snipers, stealth tanks, stealth fighter planes. No unit really sounds or looks unique, but each unit has useful functions in the battlefield. Foot units are weak and vulnerable to just about every kind of enemy, but they're the only units that can capture building units, which can either generate revenue or produce more units on the field. Some units have special abilities, such as the Spec Ops Foot Soldier, as he can not only capture and fight other foot soldiers, but also fire mortars at vehicles when at good distances from those vehicles. At close range though, vehicles are devastatingly powerful, the strongest of which is the tank. The careful thing to consider about any vehicle is that they consume fuel per turn, and so their fuel consumption should be carefully managed either by using support vehicles like trucks and transport boats, or by placing them inside your own cities. While every unit is only able to attack when right next to the target unit, stealth units are the exceptions. When they go in stealth mode, they have limited range from where they can attack the enemy, and until spotted, they're completely invisible to the enemy. With such diverse functions of each unit, the gameplay at work is quite deep. There's so many different available strategies to beat the game, especially including the fact that the game features 15 different divisions, all of which have special weaknesses and strength, and even special abilities, as the division kills more units and or gets damaged. For example, when you choose the Ragtag division, the units are extremely cheap, and so building an army of massive size is relatively easy, but at the same time, these units have weak defense and firepower. There's a division that has limited vision but can capture buildings in one turn or less, and a division which has amazingly powerful vehicles at the cost of heavy fuel consumption. The special abilities for the most part are lame, like two hit points heal to every unit, vehicles can move farther, etc. But they are neat additions to use in battle. It's great that there are just so many different strategic divisions to choose from, even though so many to choose from can often just mean convolution and confusion. Basically, what all this means is a turn-based strategy game that is extremely deep and complex. This isn't a basic game of rock, paper, scissors like most turn-based strategy games out there. But at the same time, it requires players to think deeply about their situations and how to win. The missions are mostly fun, and trying to capture all the buildings and the factories can become really addicting. Some escort missions or chase the VIP target missions are refreshing and exciting. And up to the point, right before when the air vehicles are introduced, the enemy eye holds up pretty well. But once the air and sea units are introduced, the flaws in the enemy AI becomes extremely apparent. From that point on, the game is creative and strategic only if you want it to be. In other words, no matter how you decide to play the game, beating missions from this point on becomes a cakewalk, as the computer doesn't know how to prioritize the resources because it keeps building gunships when it could save money for more powerful and devastating units, and it also doesn't know how to strategize. Let's see. All my units are anti-air, but AI keeps producing stealth fighters? What's most disappointing is the fact that the enemy divisions are always specialists at one thing or another, like stealth division or tank division, but the computer AI never takes advantage of the specialties, but instead just rush you with everything they've got, which, against a thinking human opponent, is suicide. The extremely stupid computer AI is complemented also by slow pacing due to the dull and repetitive combat animations that occur. Once your turn is over, you have to watch the enemy move its units, and when it attacks you, you're forced to watch this short 3-second animation that plays. But this, of course, is prevalent in so many strategy games that to single out Field Commander for this flaw seems a bit unfair. Nonetheless, this flaw is in there, and it can be really annoying. The stupid AI is what really makes me wonder how great the online play must have been for this game. Playing against a competent human opponent in a game where strategy elements are so deep and complex just must have been an absolute blast. Alas, since online is dead now, we can only enjoy the simplistic level editor and the 50 or so campaign missions that feature solid voice acting, though with a dull script, and an average story of a terrorist organization that wishes to destroy the world by controlling the world's weather, of all things. It's a very nice game for the PSP. It's just that I often imagine what it must have been like if I played it when all its features were fully functioning.